Last year, Samsung's entire marketing budget seemed to be revolving around one key theme: join the flip side, insinuating that as soon as you saw one of these magnificent, flexible smartphones, you wouldn't be able to help yourself but to go out and buy one. The problem is, though, that for most of the years these phones have existed, there have been some pretty serious downsides to owning one. The cameras were worse, the displays were worse, the performance and the battery life were worse, and they weren't very durable. So where are we now? With the Galaxy Z Flip 6, it feels like we're reaching a point of maturity. In fact, it feels a lot more grown up than before. I'm Cam Bunton from Trusted Reviews. Let's dive in. Now, getting the blindingly obvious out of the way first, any device with a moving part, like a hinge in the middle, is going to be less durable than one without. It adds a point of weakness in the frame and also subjects the display inside to repeated pressure points. In older models, this led to some heavy users finding the outer display layer peeling away from the display underneath. And we're told this time, though, that things are more sturdy and more durable than before. The stronger hinge opening and shutting motion is smooth, and there's very little in the way of looseness or wiggle room in general. Part of that feeling is down to the solid, flat aluminium edges running around all four sides. But also, the hinge mechanism is noticeably tighter and stronger, and with the gap when shut being almost completely gone, there's not much room for dust or fluff to get in these days either. Of course, compared to glass, the flexible material used to cover it is obviously softer, and can be damaged easily if exposed to sharp objects. It's also not as optically clear as glass, and attracts fingerprint smudges really easily too. But it is worth throwing in here that it has an IP48 rating, which means it's as water resistant as it gets, and it can stop small particles from getting inside, as long as those particles are larger than 1 millimeter, so it's not dustproof. But the best thing about Samsung's approach to this type of device, however, is the same as it always has been. It's super compact when it's shut. This makes it convenient, easy to carry around, and has a design that somehow bridges a gap between minimalism and cuteness, no doubt helped by some of the playful colors on offer. Now, moving on and following up on the major cover screen upgrade from last year was always going to be a challenge. So Samsung just stuck with the same one. It's the same 3.4-inch cover display that was on the Z Flip 5, which is kinda useful, but its small size does mean that for tasks like reading and replying to messages or navigation in Google Maps, it's a little bit more cramped than what you'd find on the Motorola Razr series. Unlike the Razr 50 Ultra as well, you don't get to load any app you want on that outer screen. There's a pre-selected group of apps that will work, but this feature's not even enabled by default. Still, for those apps that it does work with, it's convenient and means being able to quickly reply to messages on the fly without needing to open up the phone. And what Samsung does do well with the outer display is those frequent, quick interaction type functions. Things you do regularly on your phone, but maybe things that you don't think about all that often. Like seeing what music track you're listening to and skipping to the next track in your playlist. Plus, you can customize the screen quite a lot as well. You can add full screen widgets for things like weather, calendar, and Samsung health data, or if you want to, cluster widgets together on one screen to save swiping through them individually. As always, it's useful for setting up hands-free selfies and videos as well. Because that hinge design is sturdy and has the right amount of resistance, you can set the phone to almost any angle to shoot those and it will hold. From the small screen on the outside to the big one on the inside now. And there are both positives and negatives with the large 6.7-inch internal foldable display on the Z Flip 6. In the pros column, you have the fact that you get this large display panel that folds down into a convenient, pocketable form. But it is worth remembering one inescapable truth. It may be large in diagonal measurements, but the surface area isn't actually all that huge. For instance, the Galaxy S24 Plus, a standard smartphone, also has a 6.7-inch display. But because the aspect ratio is less narrow, you get quite a lot more actual display real estate. And that matters when you're watching videos that are 16:9 or 18:9 ratio, which is effectively all videos. The pillar boxing on the Flip is real. It means a lot of the time it's like watching a tiny 5.3-inch display. Now, of course, some apps like YouTube will let you expand to fill the entire space, but if you do that, you'll inevitably end up with slices of the video cropped out. It's clear then that this internal display has some way to go before it's as good for watching movies and TV shows as a more traditional smartphone screen is. Still, as foldable displays go, it's really rather good. I tested it side by side with the latest Motorola flagship, and compared to that phone, the display was almost always clearer, crisper, and easier to see. And it was more visible even in tricky conditions outdoors in bright daylight, especially when I wasn't looking at it directly head-on while shooting photos and video at awkward angles. It's also capable of reaching 2600 nits peak brightness, with 120Hz adaptive refresh rates and AMOLED goodness to ensure that it's bright, smooth, and vibrant. Now, let's talk cameras, and sure, you don't get the quadruple or triple camera systems that you get on the more expensive flagship smartphones. Phones like the S24 Plus or the S24 Ultra, which means you don't get a dedicated zoom lens. But in my time with the Z Flip 6, I can't say that I really missed it all that often. Part of the reason for that is that it has the same 50 megapixel primary camera that's in the Galaxy S24 Plus, which means it's a very strong performer in pretty much any situation. Whether it's bright daylight, evenly lit, heavily backlit with lots of shadows, dusk, nighttime, indoors or outdoors, you can pretty much guarantee the phone will take a picture quickly, reliably, and give you a good sharp result at the end of it. A big part of that is the image processing done by the internal hardware and any algorithms, but it's also the improved sensor in that main camera, which is better at capturing light and creating depth of field than its predecessor was. And because of its size and the pixel count, when I press the 2x zoom button or even at times the 4x zoom option, I can still get sharp, good-looking shots with little in the way of roughness or noise, at least in bright light situations. At 4x, especially in lower light though, there's a sense that the algorithm or AI processing colors in some of the texture and the detail, so that it looks more like a drawing than a realistic photographic capture, but I was still generally impressed that I never really felt the need for a dedicated zoom camera. Plus, it has an ultra-wide as well. That ultra-wide is still a little weak compared to the main camera, with images looking a little grainier and rough compared to the primary, but it matches colors well and is perfectly adequate for bright scenes. Video is similarly strong and offers effective stabilization while shooting handheld on the move. With 4K at 60 frames per second, vibrant colors and effective processing of light and contrast, videos look good. It does a great job of ensuring bright skies don't get blown out and overexposed while keeping your face or subject from being too dark and shadowed, even when using the poorer internal camera. Now, briefly on software, things are much the same as they have been for the last 12 months. You get a few optimizations for the foldable form factor, like the ability to push whatever app you're into the top half of the display when you part fold the phone, and then have controls in the bottom half. For apps without custom controls, you can get a touchpad for controlling the on-screen cursor, which is pretty cool. Otherwise, there's AI stuff, as with any new Galaxy. This includes generative image features that let you sketch on any photograph, and it'll generate a realistic or 3D object to represent that sketch, and it can be both surprisingly good and surprisingly bad. For instance, I drew a crude cat in one photo, a frog in another, and a butterfly in yet another, and it translated them perfectly, even using the colors that I'd used in the sketch. Now, moving on to talk performance, and there's no denying with the Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 and a vapor chamber inside, the Z Flip 6 is an incredibly capable phone. It'll benchmark up there with some of the biggest, beefiest flagship monsters. There is something of a caveat here though. It can run them, and run them really capably, but not for really long periods. Once I started really putting the Z Flip to task, it started getting noticeably warm in the top half after 15 to 20 minutes, and frame rates become inconsistent. It is worth noting here, however, this is when running tests specifically designed to put phones under extreme stress. For casual games or any types of games or social media that you do in everyday type situations, it handles itself really well. The Z Flip held its own, with no sluggishness, slowdown or overheating even after half an hour of constant usage. It's just when you go to those absolute extremes and test it for really long periods, that's when it starts to struggle a little bit. Now, if you're a light user, the Z Flip 6 might just be your dream phone when it comes to battery longevity. If you're the type of person whose phone is mostly in standby, screen locked, off, and used for maybe an hour or two a day, there's a chance you can get this phone for a couple of days between charges. But with my own casual, relatively light usage at home, using about 3 hours or so of screen time mixed between a few low-intensity games, apps, and tasks, I could finish the day with around 35 or 40% left. If, however, you're more likely to spend anywhere between 5 and 6 hours using the internal display for gaming, scrolling mindlessly through short video streams, or WhatsApping constantly, you won't struggle to drain the Z Flip's relatively small 4000 mAh capacity in a day. But the battery being so small does have the advantage of being able to refill relatively quickly, Now, in the end, I've come away from my time with the Z Flip 6 without the same feeling of enjoyment or excitement as I had with some of the older models. But that's perhaps a good thing, because instead of introducing new whimsical or cool features, this time Samsung focused on practical improvements. The durability does feel better this time, the powerful processor isn't as hamstrung as before, and battery life from the relatively low capacity is pretty solid. Even the camera doesn't feel like a weak point anymore, really. In short, it's a case of the usual compromises that come with the folding flip phones being minimized to the point where this is actually just a really solid all-round phone. And that's definitely not a bad thing. Let me know what you think of the Z Flip 6 in the comments down below, or you can get me on social media. I'm at Cam Bunton. If you did like this video, please do leave a thumbs up, subscribe and tap that notification bell, and I'll see you again in the next one. Thanks so much for watching. Bye bye.